Today we talk about power and energy, two closely related concepts in engineering. In our society, we trade money for products. For engineers, the product is better standards of living for the human society. But to pay for those products, artificial lighting, heating, motor action, information storage, retrieval and processing, engineers deal with nature. And nature, let me tell you, nature takes only one kind of currency. And it's not dollars, not RMBs, euros, yens, rubles, marks, francs, liras, pesetas, drachmas, pesos, soles, bolivars, sucres, no, none of those. Nature takes only energy. Energy? Yes, that's right. Energy, the capability of doing work. Energy, the real money. Does anyone here remember what unit we used to measure energy? Joule, that's right, an uppercase J. So, energy we remember from our physics courses in high school and in first year engineering. Energy is the capability to do work. Its symbol? E, remember, E is mc squared. But E is the electric field, so we need another symbol. And we think, with an amount of energy E, we can do so much work W, then it follows that we can represent an amount of energy by the work we can do with it, W. And that's the symbol for energy, W. There it is, energy W in joules, uppercase J. But how much energy is one joule? Well, to light a regular light bulb and keep it on between 6 p.m. and 10 p.m., we need 1,440,000 joules. To run a residential building for a month, let's say 10 floors, 4 apartments per floor, 2 penthouse units, you would need approximately 400 billion joules. And I'm considering only the energy fed through the electrical system. Here in my town, a customer can buy approximately 72 million joules with $1. Another example. At noon, near the equator, the sun drops on every square meter of ground about 700,000 joules every hour. By the way, have you noticed that in each one of those previous examples we speak of energy and of the time in which we use it? There is a relationship between energy and time that is of enormous importance to the engineer. How much energy does a customer need per month? How much energy does a motor need to run every hour? How much energy can a generator deliver per second? Yes, it's about energy flow, joules per second. And that is a concept that we gave a name to in physics. Remember? It is power. That's right, power, energy flow. Joules per second, that's power. Power measured in joules per second, a unit that we use so often, we gave it a name. Joules per second is a watt, uppercase W, symbol a P. The relationship between energy and power is the same as that between charge and current. Current is the flow of charge. Power is the flow of energy. So we can integrate both expressions and find that charge is the integral of current with respect to time, and that energy is the integral of power with respect to time. But let's have a look at the graphical implication. And before doing that, allow me to have a review of a couple of mathematics concepts for the sake of those viewers who have not taken differential calculus or integral calculus in first year. Consider that there is a fountain of time y of t, and that is represented like so. Imagine that we are interested in finding what is the slope of the tangent to that curve at any point in time. That function, slope of the tangent to the curve at any point in time, is another function of time. It's a function of time that is derived from y of t. That is called the derivative of y with respect to time, and it's represented like this, dy dt, the slope of y of t at any point in time. In particular, if we want to know what is the slope of the tangent to the curve at t equals a, we evaluate dy dt like so at t equals a, and that gives us m of a, the slope of the tangent to the curve y of t at t equals a. So much for derivative. That is the meaning of a derivative. Now, what about integral? Well, if we have another function of time, f of t, like this, and for some reason that we will see later, we want to know what is the area under that curve and the horizontal time axis between two points in time, A and B, the mathematical operation that gives us that area is called the integral of f of t. Integral of f of t between A and B, between this A and that B, that is the area A under the curve between A and B. For current and charge graphically, we have Q of t. We have the charge that has crossed the checkpoint at any point in time like that. We've seen that in the previous video. Well, the slope of the tangent to that curve at any point in time tells us what is the value of the current flowing from that checkpoint. We've seen that. In particular, the dq dt at t equals a is the slope of the tangent at this point in time. That tells us what is the current flowing through that checkpoint at t equals a. And the integral? Consider that what we have is the current I of t as a function of time. The area under that curve is q, the total charge that has crossed the checkpoint between t equals a and t equals b. In mathematical notation, q is the integral of I dt between a and b. Now for power and energy. Let's say we have the energy W of t that has flowed through a point in our system. Perhaps it's the energy that's been absorbed by a customer or the energy that has been produced by a generator. Well, the slope of the tangent of that curve at any point in time is no other than the power. At t equal a, that slope is dw dt evaluated at t equals a, and that is the power absorbed by the customer at t equals a, or if it's a generator, the power delivered by the generator at t equals a, so many watts. Slope is power. Or if what we have is power absorbed by the customer as a function of time, or power delivered by generator at any point in time, the area under the curve is the total energy that has either been absorbed by the customer or delivered by the generator. In mathematical notation, that is the integral of power between A and B. Let's consider a scenario in which we have too much energy but very little power. Consider this hypothetical situation. We have a city and we need to feed energy to it. Its requirements are 9 gigawatts. That is, it needs 9 billion joules of energy every second to operate. We are given a budget, and over conscious of the need for energy, we spend most of the budget on energy, lots and lots of it. We are left with just a few dollars to purchase a tiny half a watt electric generator. That is a generator that can convert mechanical energy to electric energy at a maximum rate of half a joule every second. Out of all the gazillion joules stored in those tanks, we can convert only half a joule every second to feed the city. We are in a situation in which we have too much energy but very little power. It's possible to argue the mirror case, buying a huge powerhouse of generators with power ratings scraping the sky, and be left with very little money to buy only a spoonful of fuel. That would be a case with too much power and very little energy. Engineers have to keep an eye on both energy and power. And that is all about energy and power that I have to tell you for now. And that is the end of this lecture on electrical and computer engineering. Thank you very much.